Come here!
Hello everyone. If there's one thing After the Flash is lacking, it's actual characters. Seriously, have you seen the shit people do? Most people don't even have a character, they just roleplay with a thin veil over their real-life selves. They project their real-life desires on their characters and they play the game with their real-life intentions and goals in mind, rather than the goals of their character. Every character feels like a jack-of-all-trades. Real strengths and weaknesses are no longer seen. This leads to characters who are duller than e-girls on Academy Games, also known as Mary Sues. The My Guy enjoyers out there may already be thinking that I've covered this topic before, and the My Guy enjoyers would be correct. I've already covered this topic briefly in my collected schizophrenic ramblings, also known as the ATF Wintertide Guide. This video intends to go further in depth in the topic in way more autistic detail. Before I begin, I'd like to go over a motto which really helps with character creation and roleplay in general, and that motto is, everything should communicate something. What this means is that everything you write down for your character should reveal something about them. Many times I've seen character sheets include some of the most useless things like favorite food, favorite animal, and other shit, but what does this reveal about your character? Not much. Stray away from superficial things like that, and focus on things that make a character truly interesting and three-dimensional. With that said, how do I make a character interesting?
So who are you cosplaying?
Yakuya Togami. He is mostly the richy rich guy who's pretty much a douchebag to everyone during the game, and actually is the main antagonist, but a side antagonist. He usually would ruin the trials.
Really?
Yeah.
You know what's crazy about that? I don't give a shit.
With a topic as vast as character creation, there is no real place to start. So instead of giving you a step-by-step guide on how to create a character like you're a lobotomite, or spewing word diarrhea in the form of esoteric ramblings with no structure, I'm going to split this section up into mini sections. In no particular order, these will cover traits, values, inner conflict, and other important aspects of the character creation process.
Now let's see how it looks so far.
The backstory is typically the first thing many people think of when creating a deep character. I wouldn't blame them for thinking this way either. Ever since the first faction we've joined, we've been told to write a 1-3 paragraph backstory detailing our character's past. But the issue with this is that we've never been told how to make an actually good backstory. Because of this, these backstories turn into 1-3 paragraph snooze fests, chock full of useless information. No one needs to know about your character attending school and getting mediocre grades unless it reveals something about the character. And that's what backstories should strive to do. They should reveal the reasons why your character acts and thinks the way they do, not drone on about your character's uneventful childhood. Let's say your character's flaw is that they're greedy. We incorporate this into the backstory by explaining how they became greedy. Perhaps their father was a shrewd merchant and instilled the idea of valuing money above all else into their son. The main idea is that you use the backstory to explain why your character is the way they are. Leave out the unimportant fluff. In the intro I mentioned Mary Sues, but I didn't really go in depth. A Mary Sue is a character who has no flaws whatsoever and often serves as wish fulfillment. Examples from media being Kirito from Sword Art Online or Rey from Star Wars. These characters are harmful for a roleplay environment not only because they lack any real character flaws which add tension and drama to the story, but also because they're usually used as self-inserts for the people playing as them. So how do we stray away from these Mary Sue characters? We give our characters meaningful flaws which affect the way they act in roleplay. These flaws can be physical, mental, or anything in between. Excessive pride, physical deformities, and bad lifestyle choices are all examples of flaws. The most important thing with flaws, though, is that they contribute to both internal and external conflict, but I will get into that later. It's also important to note that your character is not permanently stuck with this flaw, most of the time. If your hand is cut off, you unfortunately will not be able to grow a new one back, but this can be the source of another flaw which your character can work towards overcoming, also known as character development. A situation which mirrors this scenario almost one-to-one is Jaime Lannister from Game of Thrones. Jaime was one of the best swordsmen in Westeros and a member of the Kingsguard, so when he lost his fighting hand he felt useless and he no longer had purpose. His right hand was also what he used to abuse and hurt others, so by losing his hand, he grew as a character into a more humble man. The counterparts of flaws are, of course, strengths. An important thing to consider before we get into this topic is that your strength does not counteract your flaw. You cannot be greedy and charitable at the same time. With that said, strengths can be physical or mental, just like flaws. Maybe your character's physical strength is that they're great at playing music, while their mental strength is passion for their craft. Their flaw could be that they fear rejection from others and therefore fear playing their music in front of other people. There are a number of ways to find different strengths and flaws, even entire books on the subject. I encourage you to do some research of your own on the subject, and find some flaws and strengths that are truly interesting and conducive for roleplay. Values are what your character puts above all else. They're core truths that they fully believe in. An example of a good combination of values are violence is absolutely abhorrent to me, and I must protect my friends. This leads to, as the title of this section suggested, conflict. Conflict is an absolute necessity in storytelling, and every story has it. The previous scenario can lead to what's referred to as inner conflict. This is when different aspects of your character battle over the outcome of a decision. This inner conflict doesn't have to be exclusive to values. It can even be something like, do I talk to this girl and risk embarrassing myself, or do I not? Going back to the previous example of values, let's say that this character's friend is being threatened to be killed by a bandit. Will that character stick to their values and potentially allow their friend to come to harm, or will they harm the bandit to save their friend? If they choose to violate one of their core values, how will going against that value affect their character? Will they become bitter and cynical, or perhaps have a mental breakdown? Maybe they were able to find a creative solution where they were able to save their friend from harm without hurting the bandit. Just by having these values, it's created much more flavorful roleplay for you and those around you by having these conflicting values. And here it is, our final night alive, as the earth burns to the ground. Oh girl, it's you! The greatest motivator is fear. Fear of the darkness and the creatures that lurked within it is what led the caveman to creating fire. The fear of not fitting in is what led us to conform to the toxic mindsets which ATF has. So how do we use fear in character creation? We use root fears. These aren't specific fears like the fear of large bodies of water. We need to dig deeper for the root of these fears. Why does your character fear large bodies of water? Because they may drown. Therefore, the fear isn't rooted in water, but the fear of death. You may also come to another conclusion for why they fear large bodies of water. Maybe it isn't death, but the unknown. You should also consider how your character reacts when they're confronted with their root fear. If your character fears the unknown and they're suddenly plunged into a pitch black ruin, how will they react? Will they freeze up? If they fear death and someone is charging at them with a knife, will they try to fight back or run away? How will having to confront that fear affect your character? Will they become paranoid of abandoned ruins or avoid the area where they were attacked by that person with the knife? There are a multitude of ways to further develop your character through confrontations with your greatest fear. Now that we have much of our character down, how is their personality expressed outwardly? The best way to start is determining your character's disposition. A disposition is the mood they're typically seen in. Is your character typically happy, or maybe they're perpetually melancholic? Next, how open are they towards strangers, and how does your character's disposition affect this? If your character is usually happy, they're also probably very expressive and open towards others compared to the melancholic character, who's far more likely to be reserved. There are numerous other questions you can ask to determine your character's presence, such as how they walk, their posture, etc. A good way to add further character is through speech patterns and accents. Maybe your character says I instead of yes after spending a life at sea. Maybe your character grew up well off and therefore speaks very properly compared to one who grew up impoverished and speaks with street slang. If your character has a unique accent, write that into your dialogue as it can really distinguish you in roleplaying. For the love of God, please do not incorporate internet slang into your dialogue, though. You look like a complete moron when you do so. Patient, yeah, oh, I was patient. Hey, oh. Now I can scream that we made it. Now that we have a character down, we need to actually roleplay with them. You can make the greatest character of all time, but they're worth fuck all if you don't actually roleplay with them. I preach on this channel to create your own roleplay instead of looking for it, and this is one of the ways to do that. You need a drive for your character and goals to accompany it. A quote from Attack on Titan puts this best.
We humans, we're all the same. Every last one of us. For some, it's drinking. For some, it's women. For some, even religion. Family, the king, dreams, children, power. All of us had to spend our lives drunk on something, else we'd have no cause to keep pushing on. Everyone was a slave to something.
What is your character a slave to? Are they a slave to guaranteeing a comfortable future for their family? This is their drive. Other examples of drive include revenge against someone or redeeming yourself for a past misdeed. To accomplish this, they need to set smaller goals for themselves. Perhaps if your character is driven by redeeming themselves for their past as a raider, they accompany wastelanders outside of town to protect them and give them guidance. Concepts for drives and goals are truly limitless. However, I recommend you tie them back into your character's values and root fear somehow.
Are you winning, son?
We now have an awesome character, and it's also the time to be quiet about it. I don't want to see you doing actions that reveal way too much about your character. If you hate the poor, show me you hate the poor. Don't outright say it in your actions. Sneer and spit when you pass by some groveling poor person. Talk down to them, express it. Don't tell others about your character's thoughts or depressing backstory through actions. We're not mind readers, for God's sake. It's so awkward when I'm roleplaying with someone and they begin narrating what they're thinking through actions. That adds very little to the roleplay. How are others supposed to react to that? They can't. I mentioned in the Guide to Wintertide the inner character and outer character, and that still very much applies. To explain, the internal character is everything you know about your character. Everything we just developed. Their motives, goals, dreams, etc. The external character, on the other hand, is the culmination of everything working together inside the internal character. The external character is what fellow roleplayers see. The decisions your character makes as a result of their personality. Allow only yourself to truly know your inner character. Also, you should only roleplay what you know. Roleplayers are both actors and writers, and the most important part of acting is to be convincing. If you don't know anything about medicine, don't roleplay as a doctor without first doing enough research to convincingly roleplay as one. I'm not saying you need to attend Johns Hopkins or read a medical textbook. Just look up a few guides on Google on how to roleplay healing different kinds of wounds. I want to really reinforce that. You don't need to do it 100% accurately, you just need to do it convincingly. In fact, if you're overly detailed or technical in your actions, it could detract from roleplay as a person you're roleplaying with may not even know what you're talking about. This is why it's important to see if there's a guide on how to roleplay something before looking at a real-life technical manual on the subject. Lastly, ensure your character is actually playable. What this means is that they should have reasons to interact with people. I can't tell you how many times I've seen some antisocial character running away from social contact and turning down anyone who tries to roleplay with them. Don't be this guy. You hardly ever create or receive any meaningful roleplay and leave feeling like you didn't get any roleplay. It's not the game, it's you. A character's appearance is extremely subjective, so I'll mostly only be giving tips on what you should be considering when designing one. Instead of thinking about what amalgamation of e-boy hairs you're going to pile on, or what military equipment you're going to add, or how to add that obnoxious smoke effect for your cigarette, think about this. Think about finding ways to express your character through their appearance. This is such a simple idea, yet I hardly ever see it used to its full potential. Think about your character's past and personality and how it would affect their appearance.
So I did that stupid fucking trend where you put your phone in the back, in your back pocket, and you record while you walk around the store so you can see who looks at your ass. And I'm about to tear up because of this. Nobody looked at my ass.
As I said, the most important thing to consider is your character's personality and backstory when designing a character. If your character spent a large part of their childhood inside, they'd likely develop myopia, so get them glasses. If your character is poor, have that reflected in their outfit by choosing more ragged and dirty looking clothing. You can even express character through hairstyle. Think about why a male's hair may be untidy. Is it because they're a slob, too caught up in other things to care about appearance? If they have short and well-groomed hair, it may be because they work in a more formal environment or value a professional appearance. Women may have shorter hair because they value practicality and function over appearance, or it's a requirement for their work environment. Or a character could just wear their hair a certain way because they like it that way. That always works too. You should also consider your character's backstory and scaling. If your character is a merchant who spends most of their waking hours sitting in a comfy chair exploiting cheap labor, they'll likely be shorter and overweight. On the contrary, if you're one of those exploited laborers, you would probably have a more lean appearance from hard labor. All of these factors working together can really communicate a lot about your character before someone even meets them.
I think he's lying.
Is that a gram?
New card. What do you think?
Finally, you need to make your player card. If you haven't come up with a name for your character, now's the time to do so. I usually like giving my characters names which tie back into their backstory or personality somehow. If my character's personality is adventurous, I may look up names of famous explorers and choose one I like. I may also look up names which relate to outdoors or adventure. Next is the bio. For the love of God, please don't write shit in there that I can say on your character. I don't need to know your character is 6 foot 2 inches and 182 pounds, or that they have brown hair. I have fucking eyes. I'm standing right in front of you. I can tell that they're tall. I can see your hair is brown. You also don't need to drone on about all of your cool equipment. Just put that shit on your character. I promise you that people will see it. We have such an advanced character customization system, yet people still try to tell everything about their character through the player card. Try to keep whatever you put in their brief, too. I can't tell you how many times I've seen someone put a paragraph or two worth of information in there. A, no one has time to read all that in the middle of roleplay, and B, most of the time I can't even fucking read it. Have you seen how it scales in-game? It's so tiny, it's not even worth struggling to read it. After you've made your character's appearance and player card, it's finally time to roleplay. Good luck. This has been a lengthy video to say the least, and I think anyone is able to make it all the way through to the end. This video has only scratched the surface of creating a character. To truly do justice to this topic, this video would have to be several hours long, and no one has time for that. I urge you to instead do your own research on this topic. Truthfully, this video is made using many different reference materials, all of which played a large part in the making of this video. I'm going to leave a Google Doc in the description, which is all the websites I used. I hope this video has helped you in some way when making your character, and most importantly, remember to have fun doing it.
And as long as I got my suit and tie, I won't leave it off on the floor tonight. Baby got fixed up too, and I'm gonna show you a few things. All dressed up in black and white.